On this edition of Inside Texas Tech, we'll take a look at Transitions, a public art piece on display in the Commons dining area. And Kliff Kingsbury sits down with Chancellor Kent Hance to talk about the bright future of the football program. But first, we take a look at a new era in petroleum engineering inside the recently completed $22.8 million Terry Fuller Petroleum Engineering Research Facility.
Welcome to our new petroleum engineering building. This is so spectacular when you walk in.
One step inside the new Terry Fuller Petroleum Engineering Research Building, and you'll see what sets it apart. The $22.8 million addition to the north end of the engineering key boasts more than 42,000 square feet of modern classrooms, laboratories, and cutting-edge technology, from innovative displays.
And the first thing you see is our geologic rock wall here. And what this rock wall tells the story of is the evolution of wellbores.
To aesthetic details, students in the Bob L. Hurd Department of Petroleum Engineering will benefit from every thought put into the new building. Equipped with cutting-edge laboratories, students will gain a hands-on approach while learning the entire spectrum of petroleum exploration and production.
This is what we call our unconventional laboratory. Anadarko gave us funded this room here. This is where we look at unconventional rock shales and research how best to extract oil and gas most efficiently, I should say, out of that type of rock. This is the Michael Hurd Fracturing and Production Technology Laboratory, and that's where we'll be doing a lot of rock mechanics and production. This is our reservoir simulation and geologic workstations. So this is a unique lab. This is what we call our visualization lab, which we don't have anything like that right now. And the idea here is to build experiments, models, etc. They'll help the students visualize what we're teaching them.
Another eye-catching aspect lies in the two-tiered classrooms, massive HD screens that measure 115 square feet.
We can animate stuff, and we can play videos of in the oil field. If we had 3D images and things like that, that's what I really like.
Since Texas Tech University has consistently graduated top-notch, sought-after engineers, it was important to give them an edge for when they enter the workforce.
We'd like to emulate as much as we can what they'll see when they get out in industry. But this is where our drilling simulator stations. We'll have four stations in here, one there, one there, one there. Well, the student actually will see the drilling rig, the floor of the drilling rig, and things moving, and actually industry has the same thing. And they simulate wells taking a kick, getting ready to blow out and do kind of bad things, and you know, what do you do in this type of situation?
The Texas Tech Restaurant, Hotel, and Institutional Management Program, or RIM, is preparing professional individuals to make a contribution quickly in the industry. We give you a behind-the-scenes look at one of their hands-on programs, Skyviews of Texas Tech.
I chose RIM because when I was 16, I worked in a restaurant, and my manager was just very influential to me. She loved her job, she made me love my job, and she was just really a good role model for me. And so it made me really like the restaurant and hotel industry in general, and so I chose to go down that path for my career.
I went to school at a community college for 2 years, and then I realized I didn't know what I wanted to do with my life, per se, and I randomly moved up here to Lubbock to be with friends, and I started working at the Overton Hotel and Conference Center and started off as a front desk agent, and from there I found out about RIM, and I found out that I had a major passion for people and hospitality, and so that's what led me to RIM and started my career here at Texas Tech.
Each week the theme changes with the different managers. We all rotate through the positions, so they have the themes picked out and we get to choose which we would like to do. The theme is Disney, and our title is Once Wish Upon a Star, and we're doing just, it's kind of like Cinderella's Castle.
I've never been really good at networking and selling, and the people I've met, day one, my first day at RIM, I met a lot of good friends through that I'm still friends with today. Even my partner I met that I'm with, that I have in dinner series, I am partnering with him today, and we were in class the first day I started with RIM. So definitely the experience, I do definitely feel more mature in the hospitality setting from everything I've learned with the RIM program. If you have a passion, I mean, hospitality has to be passion. You're working long hours every single day from morning to night. If you have passion for making people happy and for serving the people, then definitely go for RIM. Definitely go for hospitality, because it is all about passion and serving the people and what can you do to make them feel better about themselves every day.
The Texas Tech Public Art Program was started by the Board of Regents to invest in the campus environment as an extension of Tech's educational mission. Since 2001, some amazing artwork has been displayed all over the campuses of the Texas Tech University system. In this story, we'll take a look at a new piece called Transitions that is on display in the Commons.
Installed in August 2012, the public art piece titled Transitions hangs in the main dining area of the Commons by United Supermarkets at Texas Tech University. After being selected from 6 proposals, the sculpture was created by Studio Arts Desire of Garland, Texas, and is made of approximately 400 individually hand-blown glass spheres and a monolith suspended by hair-thin wire. The monolith is constructed of several carved high-density foam blocks, and the glass spheres are blown in shades of blue, green, yellow, and red. The paths that the spheres take through the monolith are meant to correspond to the paths students take through the university, while the use of red symbolizes the impact Texas Tech has on a student's life and college experience. A 2-story dining facility, the Commons by United Supermarkets, was named after the company donated $3 million to the university. The building includes separate food courts and dining areas on both the main floor and mezzanine level, of which the installation can be seen when looking out onto the campus through 3 floor-to-ceiling arched windows. The public art program at the Texas Tech University system was initiated by the Board of Regents in 1998 as an investment in the campus environments at each of its universities. Since then, more than 90 items created by some of today's leading artists have been added to our campuses.
When we return, Chancellor Kent Hance sits down with Texas Tech's 15th head coach, Kliff Kingsbury, to talk about how he persevered to achieve his coaching aspirations by the age of 34.
This is Texas Tech University.
We inspire.
We discover.
We succeed.
We ride.
We share our traditions.
And our innovations.
We are champions.
We work hard.
And play louder.
We are many things.
But wherever we go.
And whatever we do.
Every day.
Every day.
Todos los días.
Every day.
Every day, we are Red Raiders.
Very little.
I mean, I don't know how much I can tell you.
I have just checked myself before I open my mouth.
No, I don't think I can give that away.
Oh, God, I'll get in so much trouble.
Cut all of it.
The arc for Mary over the season is bringing her back to the point where she could entertain the notion that she could fall in love again.
The series starts with Mary being very much in mourning. Still, 6 months on. It's almost like she's in this very kind of dark space for that first episode.
Edith becomes more proactive in the management of Michael Gregson's firm.
You'll see that in the changes in how she dresses and how she styles her hair. You know, she is becoming a modern woman.
In the upcoming season, we have lots of new characters coming in. Tom Cullen, who's playing a character called Tony Gillingham, who is an old family friend, or Julian Ovenden, arrives to play a character called Blake. And Gary Carr, who's joining the show, with been some interest in the first black character to come into the show.
Whether it turns out well or not, I guess you just have to watch the show.
Chancellor Kent Hance invited Texas Tech's head football coach Kliff Kingsbury to his leadership class to talk with the students about his strict upbringing and achieving his coaching goals at a young age.
We got Coach Kliff Kingsbury with us. You were born and grew up in New Braunfels, and your dad was a football coach.
And my mom was a teacher there, so I couldn't get away with anything at New Braunfels High School.
Was there any problems having your dad as a coach?
Not really. He was just always a little bit harder on us, you know. He'd make sure.
You and your brother?
Me and my brother.
You had a brother that was?
One older brother, 2 years older than me.
What did he play?
He played defensive line and offensive line.
Defensive line, he liked to hit.
Yeah, he's big. Big, tough guy. He liked that. I didn't like it too much. I had a rough growing up with him. But it makes you tough.
You were a good student. That didn't happen just when you got to Texas Tech.
It did not, yeah. And having both my parents as educators was big. They always taught me to be competitive in everything I did. And so, you know, there was a level of success in the classroom that was acceptable, and then that was it. And so I was held to that at an early age, and that stuck with me throughout, you know, my academic career.
So when did you first hear from Tech?
Late in the game, literally like a week before signing
day. Coach Dykes was the coach.
He was the, and I loved it, loved him, loved their staff, and but didn't hear anything until late, a week before signing day. Heard from Coach Dykes, and he came down. And
They didn't call you or anything until a week before the signing
day?
Yeah,
not much at all. You know, I knew him from summer camp, but that was it, though.
And so they called you, and did they offer you the signing day, or was it afterwards?
No, it was before, but right before Spike Dykes came down, I guess somebody had dropped a scholarship, and they had one open, and they offered it to me right before. And
you started against OU.
OU, yes, sir. Last game of the year, and it was our head coach was Spike Dykes. Everybody knew it was going to be his last game. So, like, there wasn't enough pressure already. It was like we had to win for Coach Dykes to send him out, and it was my first start ever, so I didn't sleep much that week. But it was, you know, Bob Stoops had just got to OU. They were up and coming and had a good team. We're, I think, about 20-point underdogs, and everybody got fired up for Coach Dykes and came out there and found a way to win. And it's still my favorite win I've ever been a part of, just because he meant so much to Texas Tech and to me personally. And they carried him off the field in his last game, and it's something I'll never forget. Coach Leach came in my sophomore year and did a good job. You know, we ran a spread offense, which the Big 12 hadn't seen, and so we were throwing it all over, a little ahead of our time. Now everybody runs that offense, but back then it was really just us. And
your senior year, who was on that team with you? I know Welker was. And he caught a couple of touchdown passes.
Yeah, Wes, for those of you who've seen him play, he was as good as he's in NFL, he was twice as good in college, just a tremendous player. And he's a huge Red Raider. He texts me all the time talking about recruits and players, and so he's very excited about Texas Tech.
Well, you had a good career there, and then when it came to pros, you did not get drafted.
I did.
You
did? I did.
What round?
Sixth round of the Patriots.
Okay. Well, I apologize. That's one of the... Yeah. Can't believe I didn't know that.
If you're a quarterback, you get drafted with the Patriots, you're kind of watching. You're not playing too much. They got a pretty good player there. But it was fun to learn from him and watch his work ethic and what he was
Tom
about.
Tom Brady.
Tom Brady, yes. I wish I could say something bad about him, because I swear to God he made a deal with the devil with his life. But he's just the best guy, hardest worker you've ever seen in your life.
He's a good guy. Good guy to be around.
He's the best guy, knows everybody's name in the facility, shakes everybody's hand, treats everybody with respect. And I guess that's why God gave him Giselle for that. If that works. How it works out.
Well, now that you brought it up, is she pretty in person?
She's stunning. Yeah, she's tall and beautiful.
Stunning.
Stunning.
That'd be the word.
Stunning. Yes, stunning.
Okay. Now, did y'all go to the Super Bowl your first year?
We did in
03. You got a ring.
I did.
What was it like the week of the Super Bowl?
It was actually in Houston, so it was incredible. I mean, it was parties and, you know, and I wasn't playing, so I could partake a little bit. And it was a fun week. I was a third-string quarterback, but the way I was calling my agent trying to get into parties, you would have thought I was Tom Brady. I was working it to try and get into him. So
let me in there.
Yes, find a way.
At what point time did you think, I'm not going to make being a pro football player for a career?
Yeah, that was my whole dream growing up, was to be an NFL quarterback. And so I kept chasing. I got up to Canada and dealt with that cold for a year. And I just was like, all right, that's enough. And, you know, wasn't sure what I wanted to do. I was thinking about going back to get my MBA in business. And luckily I had a coaching at the University of Houston that asked me to come help him, and fell in love with the coaching aspect, the teaching aspect, being around the players. And so it just went from there.
When the job opened up at A&M, did he immediately ask you to go with him, or did he?
He did, and this is how this worked out, because obviously I went to Tech, so my feelings towards A&M were about what yours are, I'm sure. And so the whole time, he'd been kind of talks with UCLA, so I'm like, this is awesome. We're going out to LA. It's going to be unbelievable. So that's what I'm thinking.
You'd be an offensive coordinator at UCLA and single.
Yes, that's not bad. So I'm thinking life's good. And then it comes down to it. He comes in and is like, hey, man, took the job at A&M. So
you went, whoa.
That was a tough day. But But it worked out. It worked out. Enjoyed my time there. The fans are great. They're phenomenal.
There are a lot of good Aggies.
That's what they say. Yeah. They say. Yeah.
And I got a call from Kirby Hocutt at 10:30, and he said Tuberville's going to Cincinnati. And I said, Cincinnati? Yeah, I mean, that step down, in my opinion, to go
for it. I agree.
Does anybody disagree with that?
I don't agree.
You know? So the search began. And when did you find out that the Tech job was open? Who told you?
Yeah, just a bunch of buddies. My phone started blowing up. And so to set the scene, you know, I'd lived an entire year in College Station, so I finally get to come to New York, have a whole weekend planned out. I'm excited about my trip. Then that happens, and my phone starts blowing up, so I'm trapped in a hotel room trying to get this job, essentially. But it all worked out. I just missed out on a good New York weekend.
How's it been, being back at Tech?
It's been unbelievable. Just to share my experiences with our current team and players and how much this university meant to me and gave to me. I had one scholarship offer, and it was Texas Tech, and I mean, I couldn't love this place more.
As you travel throughout the state, do you, in airports and everything, you run into many Tech people? Or?
A ton of Tech people, and they're fired up right now, I think, with everything we have going on with your billion-dollar campaign, all you've done outside of athletics, and then, you know, Coach Smith. I mean, that basketball game the other night was incredible for those who win, that energy, and that's what we want all the time. I mean, that's what Tech's about, is y'all's passion, y'all's energy. The student body is unlike any other. We're not caught up in walking on the grass or anything like that. I mean, we're gonna come and get rowdy and have fun and do it our way, and that's the beauty of Texas Tech, and that's what I love about this place.
We appreciate you very much. Thank you.
Thank y'all for having me. Appreciate it. Thank you.
That's so good.
That's good.
That's it. Y'all want us to keep going?
Chancellor Kent Hance became the third chancellor of the Texas Tech University system in 2006. Since then, he has led Texas Tech to $1 billion and much more. We continue our series talking with Chancellor Hance, looking back at his time leading the system.
Probably the most difficult problem in dealing with something that was not earth-shattering to Texas Tech, but was earth-shattering to football fans, was when we let Mike Leach go. And the truth of that matter, and regardless what's been said by anyone, we had a complaint from a parent that a football player, was punished when they had a brain concussion. We investigated it, and there was no doubt that that's exactly what happened. No one that had ever had a brain concussion before had ever been treated that way. And the player was punished, and we begged Mike Leach to work with us for 12 days. And during that period of time, he would not work with us. He was arrogant. And I think the straw came when I was begging him to work with us, and he said, "What if I don't?" And I said, "Well, you'll probably get terminated." And when I said that, he told me to go F myself, and I didn't want to do that. And I grew up in Dimmitt, Texas, in the third grade. I knew that if you told your boss what he told me, that you were going to get fired. I told him we'd never talk again, and we didn't. But I sent Gerald Myers and Guy Bailey over to try to save him. And in the deposition, one of the funny things, there was a statement in there, there's an email that I had sent, "This is the hardest guy to save in the world." And he was. And I wish him the best. I think he's a pretty good coach. I will say this, Texas Tech is better off. We have a better coach in Kliff Kingsbury. And I've had some of the top presidents in the nation tell me that was a defining moment for Texas Tech. We're an educational institution. Education comes first. We had to keep our integrity, and we did that. I wish him the best, and we're doing fine. And that got a lot of publicity, and it got a lot of talk and everything. But as far as the history of Texas Tech and what happens at Texas Tech, it was insignificant.
On Deck, we give you an inside look at the most expensive and highly aggressive sport in the world, and follow around competitive triathletes as they push themselves, excelling in three different sports. I'm waking up, I feel it in my bones, and I don't think my system flow. Welcome to the new Polo Club offers all students the opportunity to try the tradition-shrouded historic sport of polo. All equipment and ponies are provided by Texas Tech for students to either learn how to ride or compete in polo.
I chose Texas Tech mostly because I knew it would have something where I could ride horses. It's polo and it's riding. So if you want, you can just ride, but you can also learn polo, which is the most expensive sport in the world, so why wouldn't you?
It's just a unique sport, especially out here in West Texas. So the fact that we have an opportunity to do this and have so many horses and travel so much was just a really good opportunity here.
People start from never being on a horse in their life to becoming really great riders. I mean, our team president, who's one of our best men's players, only started playing polo 2 years ago.
We are the only rec sport at Tech, I believe, who's ever won a national championship. We play all kinds of teams, like CSU, who went to semifinals in the national championship last year, and all their teams around Texas. Networking is crazy, and we have people graduating this year who are getting jobs in the polo world because of this, and because of the people they meet through traveling.
We are pretty competitive. I mean, we're a good sport about it too, but all the team comes out and helps on the days that we have games, and we have to come and cool down the horses even if we're not part of the team. The women are really good, but the men's team is just phenomenal. I mean, they're great at what they do.
Polo is really physical because when you're in the field, a lot of times the riders don't think about it, but if you're sitting there watching it, especially the men's varsity games, they're going 30, 40, 50 miles an hour, full speed on these horses, and going after a ball a little bit bigger than a softball. They're hitting each other, they're hitting the boards, their mallets hit each other. I've seen mallets broken during the game. It's a lot more physical than you would think it would be.
Definitely the roughest sport you can do on a horse. So it's really physical. I mean, the horses are running into each other, the people are running into each other. You're getting hit with balls and mallets and all kinds of stuff, like hockey on a horse, because everyone's just running around real fast, and it's not like you don't reset like other sports do.
You get to meet so many new people, and a lot of times in polo, some games we don't bring our horses. We ride the horses that they give us. So you get to ride so many different horses that have different training levels, and it really builds you as a rider. I think in just the 2 semesters that I've been in polo, I've become a much better rider, even though I've been riding my whole life.
It is really cool that Tech helps us do this. There's no other place in Lubbock you can go around and play polo or anything like that. So the fact that they help us fund this and help us feed our horses so that we can go around and travel and get this experience is a really big deal.
This competitive wing has taken numerous first place sports in a wide variety of races. And as a team, the club is placed in the top 20 at the National Collegiate Triathlon Championships. We'll give you a look at the intense training of the Triathlon Club.
Swimmers, bikers, runners, have you ever thought what might happen if you combine your skills? You'd be a triathlete.
The triathlon team is great for everyone of all levels. Like if you're just starting running at like a mile or you've been already done marathons, it's really great, and there's so many people to support you and different levels to run with and bike with, so I think it'd be great for anybody.
We actually have people from all experiences, and like I said, I didn't know how to ride a bike when I first joined, and I couldn't run more than a mile, so I started from scratch, and we actually give everyone the tools to be the best triathlete they could be. We're not all huge triathletes here. We just want to stay fit and want to have people.
I actually was going to do a triathlon with my dad. He convinced me, and he's been saying, like, you could really do this. And I was like, you're crazy. So I invited my friend to train with me, and she knew someone on the triathlon team. And I just got hooked, and they convinced me to join. And so that's what I've been doing ever since.
It all started out during the summer. I did a lot of running to lose some weight, and I kind of got hooked on the cardio workouts. I saw a friend do a triathlon in Shreveport, Louisiana, and from there, I was hooked.
And besides the six-pack abs and fabulous speedos, you could possibly make some friends.
Definitely the friendship part. I have so many friends here, and I know, like, anytime I want to go on a run or a swim, and they're there keeping me accountable. And then working out in high school, I was on the volleyball team, and that kept me going. And I don't really like working out just to work out. I want to do it for fun, so I look forward to practices.
It's very cool. It's a huge motivator, huge lift to know that
you know, if you miss, you're gonna, you know, you're not gonna be part of the group. Everyone's gonna be like, hey, you know, where'd Harry go? And when you do go, they push you to go harder, faster. The training, it's much better when you have people along with you to make you run harder, swim faster, bike longer.
We actually get over $600 worth of free races within our sponsorship. So we're sponsored by Buffalo Springs Triathlons, and so they give us, each member, a free entry to all of their races, which is a really, really great thing for our team, because if you want to work towards that as a goal, you have that within your dues.
Or at the very least, just have some great stories to tell.
So my first triathlon was actually nationals, which is pretty crazy, but I don't know how funny this is, but we got in a car wreck on the way there. An 18-wheeler hit us, but I think that made us a lot closer. Like, those who get hit by an 18-wheeler stay together.
Reporting for Texas Tech Public Broadcasting, I'm Lauren Bogle.
Thank you for tuning in. See you next Thursday right here on Channel 5, Texas Tech Public Broadcasting. And for more of our stories, check out KTTZ.org. Have a good night.